ground cinnamon. Put it in breakfast. On oatmeal, it's good. And put it on yogurt and fruit. Use this this yogurt. Let's try it like this. TJ's Greek yogurt. Yeah, it's all white. Non-fat vanilla yogurt. It's good. Tried putting a little maple syrup on it tonight. It wasn't so good. Too sweet. So, just had fruit for dinner. Tried to put too much stuff in there. Wasn't so good. So some recipes work out, some don't. I put graham crackers on top. That didn't work. I put almonds coated with sesame seeds from Trader Joe's in there. That didn't work at all. By themselves, they're great, but that didn't work at all. It was terrible. So some things are best just by themselves, and some things are better, you know, blended. If you throw everything into this pot, you know, big bowl full of stuff, not so good. Can't make the best soups are not made by pouring all the ingredients in, that is for sure. But I thought I'd try it. Won't do that again. Yeah. What is there to get? What do we have to get? What do we have to get? We have to get something. Well, maybe we need to get just one seeing. That's it. So we shouldn't be in too much of a frantic rush about it, panic about it. I guess if you were having to get a lot of stuff, then it would be, you know, it would be kind of panicky. Like, oh my gosh, how can I get all this stuff done? How can I get all this? Uh-oh. Bugs. But we only need to have one clear vision of timelessness. That's it. So let's not be in too much of a rush. Ah, the mosquitoes. Wow. Bugs, they're here. April 4th, the bugs have arrived. Speaking of bugs, the world is very buggy. And today I decided not to pay any more attention to the world because I was having a nervous breakdown looking at the news. I wasn't following my own advice. Ever since the Pope stepped down, I started paying attention to the news, which before I said, don't pay any attention to it. And I was following my own advice and everything was great. And then I started paying attention to it because I know this is the time now when troubles are really going to come. And wow, troubles came to me severely, which means I was tuning into what's to come to the detriment of the solution. There's one solution, vision of timelessness, face of Christ, vision of Christ, vision of oneness, vision of the overlay, bliss, samadhi, nirvana, all of that, peace beyond understanding. That's the remedy. So it's a remedy no matter what the news is. That's it. So we have to pay attention to that. So today I decided no more news, and the depression has lifted. I was really having a nervous depression. It lifted. It lifted amazingly. Wow. So I feel pretty good now. Whereas before I was just, I thought I can't make it. It's that simple decision. I just asked the Holy Spirit, what do I need to do? Just let me know. And, you know, stop with the news. Can't you feel the anxiety? I said, yeah. As soon as I plug into that, the anxiety's there severely. So just stop it. Yeah, okay. But I mean, don't I have to judge the news? No, don't have to judge the news. It's already non-judged. See, it's already non-judged. Everything is already non-judged. At least that's what the gurus, the saviors say. And I believe them. I have faith in them. I don't know for sure myself, but I know that they know. So, and they've also shown me consistency and clarity, purity of mode. Everything that I've seen from the great gurus, I say, you know what? I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt. I'm going to pay attention to what they have to say. They say that you can see this. I believe it. I'm going to try and see why this is so. And it requires a very wide panoramic clarity to put this in perspective. It really does. Really, it's not like just a narrow little answer. It's the answer. It is the answer. It answers everything. So if you're looking for an answer to a question, that's not it. That is not it. Look for an answer to all questions. Is there one answer to all questions? And the answer is yes. That's what the gurus say. There's one answer to all questions. That is God's perfect non-judgment upon all symbols. Symbols, hypotheticals. Symbols are just hypotheticals. You could just say, God said, non-judgment, my non-judgment upon all symbols. End of story. Eternal non-judgment concurrent with symbols, the rising of symbols, no judgment, non-judgment. End of story. Right there. And so the answer is that God knows that symbols are nothing, which is very reassuring. Because if God didn't know that symbols are nothing, that'd be very, very, very unreassuring, in fact, terrifying. Then we would say, uh-oh, symbols can threaten reality. There's some truth to them. There's some power. Symbols have some kind of power. Otherwise, God would just ignore them, of course. So if we say, well, God is not ignoring something, then that is where the trouble starts. So, of course, we're trying desperately to concoct something that we think that God will not ignore. Will not ignore. Desperately, we're trying desperately for that, which is why we have all these incredibly terrible things happening. That's the psyche out in this world. That's the play of the goddess of destructivity, as it were, which is an idol. We make idols to scare us, you see, to freak us out, to psych ourselves out. Even then, if we're psyched out, God must be psyched out too, but God's not psyched out. So we're just torturing ourselves, really, with all this stuff. And we're saying, surely God must pay attention to this, must judge this, surely, because we're judging it. We're judging so strongly. We say, well, God must be judging it. No. Mm-mm. But it takes, again, a panoramic clarity, depth to see the context of this. You have to see the full depth of the context of it. Otherwise, you get psyched out for sure. That's like even watching the news for me. That's a problem, severe problem. It's psyching my nervous system out. You see, no matter how clear we are here, we don't have perfect clarity. There's still a residual aspect of our belief system that can pull us down. Can pull us down. That's why I say take refuge in the guru. The perfect guru, take refuge in the perfect guru. Is we're still amateurs, we're still dilettantes, no matter what, compared to perfect guru, where there's no possibility of them getting confused at all. No possibility of them getting psyched out. Where can we find such gurus? I wish I knew. There have been some in history, for sure. Now I have this light here symbolizing the light of reason, the light of clarity. Have it on at all times. Have it on at all times. Because the world is going all in, as it were. It's like we're playing a hand of cards and we put all the chips on the table. You know, all in. Let's go all in. So, of course, but it's gone in all in before. And it keeps doing that. This time it may be even more. But it's trying to say, my gosh, look at this. How could, you know, look at this. This is so important. We must take a stand one way or the other on this. We must, etc. And the gurus say, no. Don't be deceived. Now, even though we're not sure about it, who do we give the benefit of the doubt to? Who do we give the benefit of the doubt to? The news is constantly amping up its attempts to freak us out through gruesomeness. Okay? Constantly pushing this gruesomeness on us and saying, look at this. Huh? Surely God must be seeing that, looking at this and shaking the head, you know, saying, surely. And if that's not gruesomeness, look at this. You see? Look at what we can do with symbols. See? It's all symbols. And we give them all the meaning that they have for us. But symbols have no meaning in reality whatsoever. Everything in reality is real. God didn't create only reality, only what is real. Did not create symbols. And we're not symbols. God created us. Everything that is real eternally. Doesn't need any symbols. So this play of symbols that we're involved with, or just a play of symbols, really, we gave everything the meaning that it has for us. We gave it. We gave it the meaning. We give it meaning. Which is hard to believe, but it's true. You have to give the benefit of the doubt, at least I do, to those who know the truth. And the media and entertainment, the world is constantly feeding us the stuff that is just so atrocious, and it's almost inescapable. And it's there's some kind of morbid fascination with it because it's so terrible. You wonder just how low can you go? Type of fascination, right? And it just never ends. It's very tiresome. And it'll get another war going and put the war up on the big screens. And now everybody has a big screen, you know, plasma or LED big screens. 60 inches, whatever. And they've got the theater surround sound, and they high def, and now we can have war in high def, theater surround sound. Think about that. So everybody's just got the popcorn, and they're just waiting for all the, you know, the drama. They can immerse themselves in it, saturate themselves in it, and be full of judgment and measurement, and be measuring all of this. Perception is just measurement. And that's the holy grail of the ego. 24/7, let's all be immersed in this gruesomeness. Together, we're gruesome. You see, that's this motto. And the ego is trying to convince us that God must be paying attention to this. Has to be. No, we cannot. And we don't realize the catastrophic consequences of believing this for our sanity, for our stability. And that's where the depth of clarity comes into play. It really does. Without that depth of clarity, we don't have a chance against this stuff, what's happening in the world. We don't have a chance. Which is why, knowing about this ahead of time, these times ahead of time, we got help. Yeah, we got help. Jesus came 2,000 years ago and he said, look, I'm going to let you do with me what you want to do. I'm going to prove what your agenda really is by giving no resistance to it. So Jesus dropped all resistance to our agenda here. And what did we do? Murdered him. Crucified him. The body, at least. And then the second part, he said, okay, now I showed you the mistake. Now let me show you the correction. And resurrection, he said, look, you can't kill God. You can't kill truth. You don't have any such power. Never have, never will have such power. So, you know, got to deal with that. Deal with it. then in recent times, 1970, was it 6 or 4, 74, 76, A Course in Miracles was published, which gave very detailed, clear explanations of a very amazing belief system. And it just so happens that this belief system is the antidote to the times that we're in now. It's the antidote. So in other words, the antidote was given out as we began to move into that, which was in the mid-70s, actually. The mid-70s is when things really started to get cooking. And so the antidote was given out concurrent with that. For those who were aware, had this feeling. I was aware ahead of time of the troubles to come. So I was searching for this antidote, which I knew would be given in the world. I came into the world with the knowledge there would be an antidote given out. So I must have been aware of Jesus before I was born here and knew what he was going to do. And then when I came in the world, I kept telling people, hey, don't worry. There's a great antidote that's going to come. Times are going to get bad, but there's an antidote. And then one day I came across the Course in Miracles in a bookstore. And I said, I read some of it. I said, this is it. This is the antidote. I bought it actually after a month because I said, wow, that's too difficult. I can't do it. And then I decided I have to try. And I got it and I read it and I said, wow, this is the antidote that I knew would come into the world. And it explains very clearly, you know, the great deception, the great delusion that we're under, and it shows us the way to get free of it. So these times are not a joke. This antidote is not a joke. It's a strong antidote. Because the times are really, 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 really terrible. Quantum gruesomeness. And it's going to get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And it's so bad, at some point you have to stop her. I was having a nervous breakdown, going into severe depression. And just said, whoa, this is incredible how potent it is. You just take a step back and don't pay any more attention to it. But Jesus is basically telling us we don't have to pay attention to it. It serves absolutely no purpose. The world serves no purpose at all. None. Because it's trying to change reality, and reality can't be changed. So what purpose does it serve? None. However, we can give it a new purpose of continuity to solve the continuity issue. In fact, God already gave it that purpose, knowing that this is so. Holy Spirit provides the continuity for us by presenting this non-judgment of God as bliss, timeless, a vision of timelessness. We're trying to psych ourselves out. All these crazy things that are happening. I don't know why I started watching the news again, because I know it's you should not do that. You just have these non-stop shootings, you know, it's just like now it's so commonplace. People crashing into buildings, just mayhem, really. Mayhem is coming. And we're all sitting there in front of our TVs, you know, watching this mayhem. Why? Why? Is Jesus sitting in front of a TV watching mayhem? Are the great teachers watching this mayhem saying, oh my gosh, I gotta be like Superman and go down and stop that because God's really angry about that. or those poor people, I've got to come to their rescue and get the bad guys, get the villains. You know, if Jesus comes back, or when he comes back, it's going to freak a lot of people out and they won't pay any attention because Jesus will be completely calm, completely relaxed, completely blissful, completely unconcerned. And who can handle that? That's a tough one, isn't it? I've been trained to be able to handle that. It doesn't seem to bother me too much. But there's residual, sure, absolutely. It's like, how come God isn't doing anything? You know, that's the question. How come? Why aren't you, chasing down the bad guys, stopping this stuff, stopping the mayhem, all this? Why aren't you doing that? You know, Jesus would be just sitting very calm, relaxed, quiet, blissful, peaceful. And so to not get freaked out by that is quite an accomplishment, actually. So I say, Jesus, why don't you come? Why don't you come here to the world? Why not? And the answer is along the lines of, well, you know, I can't. I don't want to freak anybody out. That's not a good use of time. I don't want. That's not my purpose to freak anyone out. So, it's up to people here in the world to raise their level of understanding, so they don't get freaked out by someone who is not freaked out by anything here in the world. People will come to Jesus with the news and say, Jesus, look at what happened. Look at this slaughter. Can you believe it? Can you please tell us that at least God condemns this? Can you at least tell us that? Please tell us that. We want you to. They beg, please, you must have God condemn this. How can a God that creates only the real be in a position of condemning anything? How is that possible? Does God create something that is not real? Does God really create anything that is condemnable? Why would God create something that he wants to condemn? That's obviously crazy. So there has to be another explanation to it, you see. So, of course, Jesus would not say any, you know, not condemn it at all. And then people say, well, you're nuts, you're not Jesus. You can't possibly be Jesus. God must hate, you know, this stuff. It must be driving God crazy to see all this stuff. And then Jesus said, no, God's not paying the slightest attention to any of this. Never has and never will. I said, huh? You're nuts, you're crazy, you know. So we're just getting a little dose of that here, you know, that passing that on, Christ's clarity, reassurance, that it is okay. It's okay. It doesn't seem to bother me, only because of the panoramic depth of clarity that I've spent a lifetime working on. That's the only reason. Other than that, of course it would bother me severely. Absolutely. Because the explanation has to start at the beginning. It has to be a total explanation. Otherwise, of course, we're going to be affected. We don't realize it's our attempt to unseat the prime creator, usurp the position of prime creator. We don't understand it's our desire to change reality that's bringing this about. We don't see that. We don't connect the dots. And we do everything possible not to connect the dots. So, people would have a difficult time with Jesus. The sob sisters would have a difficult time for sure. They say, oh, Jesus, surely, you know, look at this. Oh my God, it happened to this. You know, look what happened to this. And tears just, oh my gosh. And they're patiently waiting for their opening to find out what is it that Jesus condemns. Everyone will be waiting for that, you know, waiting for it. Patiently waiting. We know he's going to drop the secret soon, and we'll be the first ones to know. that's the idea, notion, huh? We'll be on the inside. We've got the inside scoop. What is it? Come on, Jesus, you can tell us. It doesn't condemn anything. God is not a God of condemnation, not a God of judgment. Why does God need to judge reality? Reality's flawless and perfect, and God created. He knows it's so. Eternal. Invulnerable, flawless, perfect, seamless, totally wonderful, glorious, nothing to judge. What is there to judge? What could be contrary to God's will that will require judgment? So basically what we're trying to do in this world is just trying to make it seem like there's something contrary to God's will, right? Like this couldn't have happened according to God's will. Well, the Son of God can pretend that there's something contrary to God's will, can imagine it, can hypothesize it, say hypothetically, what if this could really happen? But nothing in existence really is really happening. You can't say the dance of symbols is a real happening. It's not real. It's not, nothing's really happening at all. So of course we're trying to, we're hoping that God thinks that there's something really happening here. So then we say, aha, we have a power over reality, you see. There is this power, that even God feels threatened by this power. It's not real, but it threatens reality. So if God did judge anything here, was paying attention to what's going on here, then that would freak us out, because we're reality too, which means we would feel threatened, genuinely threatened and freaked out if there was some power that could, you know, destroy reality. So the fact that God pays no attention to any of us at all is the most reassuring fact there is, because that means that we're not threatened either. We're not really threatened at all. Nothing that's taking place here threatens what we really are, threatens reality at all. It doesn't threaten our home. It's like we're making this hypothetical, this gruesome hypothetical nightmare, and pretending that our home is threatened by it. So we're afraid to wake up, you know, and say, oh my gosh, our home is terrible. But to see all this is, you have to have an overall context where everything, this foundation, is stable. Otherwise, now only the inner guru, the perfect teacher, can help get you there. Otherwise, it's too difficult. There has to be truth. Has to be seen within. You have to see it for yourself. Otherwise, it's too difficult. So that's why the path, each one has the path of clarifying for themselves based on the guidance, the inner guidance, the guidance that they get, the grace of God, the guidance of the Holy Spirit. They get guidance and they gradually see and put it to connect the dots and then see it for themselves and realize, hey, this is so. And then all the troubles soften up and subside substantially. Although it's always possible to be lured back into that, paying attention to it all. The delusion we're in is quite a delusion. I remember waking up and seeing the delusion in 1978, and I said, wow, that is quite a delusion. That's really something. What a deceptive play of deception, self-deception. And then I got pulled back into it. I knew I was getting pulled back down into it. I said, oh boy, I'm going to be deceived for a while here. I'm going to have troubles for a while. I have to work to get back to this clarity, this momentary moment of clarity. So it is really quite a deception. Nobody should be too unsettled over whatever perception they have, however they see things. They should simply say, okay, this is how I see things now. Okay, that's okay. And then say, you know what, if I really put some effort into it, I could probably see things a little more clearly. And then just like that, don't condemn where you're at. Don't condemn where you're at all. There's no condemnation. Just say, I bet you I could get things a little more clear. And things are not quite clear enough for me. Things don't quite add up yet. So let me keep trying. And that's it. You have to be patient and kind with yourself, because of this deception is so so incredible, just so audacious. Really, it's so audacious is what it really is. The audacity of it, the sheer audacity of it, is just, it's just pure whim, you know. It's hard to explain and fathom. So we struggle, and we have to realize that we're doing the best we can, and then try to do better. Wherever we're at, say, okay, I've done the best I could up to this point, but let me see if I can do a little better right now. And then we find out that with help, we can do better. So always have this light on here. Always have this light on. The light of reason, the light of observation, the light of clarification. Do not condemn yourself. Do not condemn where you're at. Because like I said, I've been working at it like full blast for 30, 35 years. And before that, I was working at it very strongly. It's like full blast for 35 years, full blast. And especially the last 15, 16 years have been like complete emergency mode. You know, even ratchet up even higher. And still, you see, still vulnerability to this deception. Still affects my nervous system, even though my mind says I should be able to handle this. No. It's too severe. It's designed to trip us up. It's designed to trip us up, all of us up. It's designed that way. See, we're very thorough and clever about our designs. And so this situation here is designed to pull us under. That Jesus warned us, he's saying in the end times it would be so severe, the deception would be so severe that even the elect of God would be in danger of being pulled under into deception. That is true. That is very true. The elect of God are those who have elected to accept the truth of God's non-judgment. Even those are in danger of being pulled under. So I guess I thought I'd try it. I'd test it out. I said, boy, I was going under. I was going under. I was getting suicidal, the depression. I said, I can't pull out of this. This is going to do me in. And then just a simple decision to stop testing, you know, testing the waters. And then suddenly things changed just that quickly. This morning I felt like I was nearly dead, and then I decided, made a decision, and suddenly, the end of the day, I'm peppy and feeling good, and I said, wow, where's the depression? Gone. So depression is not incurable at all. It's just you have to make a decision to stop paying attention to what's dragging you down. Like we used to say in the 60s, well, this world's really dragging me down. This world's really dragging me. It's really dragging me down. This is really dragging me down, man. We'd say that. And then the drug pushers would be going around, hey, man, isn't this world really dragging you down? It's such a drag. Man, he says, hey, have some of this, man. This will help you feel better, you know. And it's easy. It's easy for drug pushers in this world, right? Because the world's always dragging everybody down. Nobody likes it being dragged down like this. Yeah, drug pushers are very smart, very clever back then, and I'm sure they are now too. They say, no, we got Jesus. Say, oh yeah, Jesus is cool too, but man, this is really cool too. You should try this. This will really help you out also, man. You're gonna get closer to Jesus with these drugs, man. You know, and they just, wow, the drug pushers are nasty. Drug pushers target you. They target you. You know, they're guided to target certain people. Absolutely. Absolutely. They say, let go. The ego, the adversary, the idol says, go get that one. Drag that one down. Hunt that one down. Like that. And they're very artful, you know, with their approach and all that kind of stuff. They're incredible. They're incredible, terrible, wicked, dangerous seducers into hell, as it were. Might be nice if they, you know, well, you got to work on the antidote. You got to work on the antidote. Find the antidote and then work on that antidote. But even then, you know, who in the world can say now that they're truly impervious to the world, impervious? No, can't say that. So we definitely need help. We definitely need help. Now, why we're not getting it? Again, I've been looking for signs in the world of those who could handle it. And so far I haven't found it. must be, you know, somewhere, but it seems like it's so difficult to find that attitude. Even the, it seems like the top teachers, I'm looking at like videos of the non-dual teachers and all these teachers, and even them, it's obvious, you know, that most of them would struggle with that for sure. Struggle if Jesus were here, struggle. So they would just, the spiritual politics is still very alive and well. And the complete, total, factual, non-compromising truth is something that we're not used to. We're not used to it. We're not used to it. It requires familiarity to handle that. So I'm sure there are some in the world, most definitely there has to be some in the world, absolutely, that could at least, you know, wouldn't bother them too much. The fact that God doesn't pay any attention to the world at all is that hurts people's pride. It hurts our pride. We say, "What do you mean? We're working so hard to get God's attention, and He doesn't pay any attention? How's that possible? That's terrible." People would say, "Oh, that's horrible. I've spent lifetime after lifetime trying to get God's attention. Now you're telling me there's no possibility I'll ever get God's attention in hypothetical land." And Jesus would say, "Yeah, that's right. That is right. That is very correct." You know, that takes a while. That's like a kick in the stomach. That takes a while to get over that one. And we think, maybe if I just learn to play some musical instrument better and compose a beautiful song or fall in love or write a great book or create a social revolution or feed the hungry or do something great, you know, God will pay attention to me here. When Jesus said, no. Your salvation comes from the fact that God pays no attention to any of this. Because we never left reality. We are one with reality. We're completely real. And symbols have no relevance to us whatsoever. So if God were to pay attention to this, I would be saying, hey, these symbols do have relevance to what you are, do have relevance to your identity. Your identity is threatened. Your identity can be destroyed. You see, that's what God would be saying. If you did something great like save somebody's life, and God would say, oh my gosh, what a great, great thing you did. You saved that person's life. And then you'll say, oh, so God believes that lives can be lost. Why else would God be judging my saving of this life to be so much, such a wonderful, important thing? And then you think, you know, if God sees it that way, it means He sees in my life, my identity can be lost too. You see that? It'd completely freak you out. So we assume that we can handle the great gurus coming here and be okay, just because we have all these non-dual teachers and various spiritual teachers of all different types, gurus, and pundits and sages and et cetera, mystics and all these things. And we think, oh, sure, but not so. There are a lot of dime store gurus, and they don't really bring it. We're not used to it. We're not used to someone who really brings it. We're not used to that. The purpose of these videos is at least do some of that, so we at least get a little flavor of that, because at some point we're going to need help here. Don't think that we can do it ourselves, that kind of thing. That's kind of overestimating our capacities. what I've seen is that we do get help at some point, definitely, probably soon. But let us not make the assumption, again, that we're all prepared. And I can tell you, yesterday I spent time looking at the non-dual stuff, and I was just like so depressed. I said, holy cow, this is not going to get people ready enough. God is not a gender, you know. It's not. Has nothing to do with existence at all. All this male female stuff is just complete nonsense. Spirit doesn't have any form, or gender, or anything like that. And all those spiritual politics that everybody's playing is silly. It's juvenile. It's really juvenile. I mean, we're still at a very juvenile phase of our considerations. In fact, the world is more juvenile now than ever. Really. There's something to be said about paying attention to your elders. You know, that's been the tradition throughout history. And now I see why that is so. I wasn't sure when I was young. I said, you know, I'm not sure what I should do. Should I pay attention to my elders or not? And I did pay a lot of attention to my elders and tried to find help there, which turned out to be the right play. Because what happens is when you get older, you don't have the strength anymore to change the world so much. You cannot form the world the way you want it. So you don't have all this hope that, hey, I can get up this morning and if I don't like my car, I can get some money and buy a new car. Or if I don't like this, I can just change it and get this. You're pretty much stuck. And you can't really transform your environment anymore when you get older. And this brings a whole new perspective on the situation. You say, wow, wait a minute. What's going on here? You don't have the vitality of youth, the optimism of youth, the energy of youth. All the stuff that's going on with youth gives a false hope to the situation. Very much a false hope. You think, hey, you know, all this stuff I don't like in the world, I can just change it. You're overflowing with all this vigor. And you just say, hey, poverty, I'll stamp it out. I can do it, I'll stamp it out. When you get older and you get feeble, as it were, as I'm experiencing now, you say, you realize I can't do a doggone thing about anything. And then that says, whoa, I'm stuck with what is right now. This is what is for me. I'm not able to transform it in that way. So what do I do? See, and then one becomes receptive to the bigger picture and realizing we can choose to change our perception. Instead of seeing time, we can see timelessness. And then timelessness transforms the world into what we truly want to see. And so even someone who's feeble will be completely in bliss and with the vision of timelessness, and doesn't matter if they're feeble or not. Does not matter. Like Ramana Maharshi, he was feeble, right? Look how feeble he was. Didn't matter to him the slightest bit. He wasn't dependent on his body to transform stuff. I mean, I got up in the morning recently and started digging ditches. And in the evening, I come home after work and I keep digging ditches. And I was transforming the yard, transforming everything, trying to turn it into like a gorgeous place. And I just completely wiped myself out. And I can't do that anymore. And I don't even dare try it now at this point. My whole system like collapsed almost and hasn't recovered yet. That's kind of like a last gasp kind of thing. Like, you know what? If I don't like the way the world looks, if I don't like the way my surroundings look, I can transform them into something gorgeous and beautiful and keep it that way. But the maintenance and everything is too much. And so youth laughs at the notion that we need to accept the world as it is and don't try to change it. It says, oh no, I can change it. And then it burns itself out and at some point it realizes, wow, Or some older people give all their money to you young people and say, "Here, you go transform the world for me," you see. Or others wiser would say, "Now, wait a minute. Maybe what the youth needs is examples and to show them the truth of the situation. Instead of trying to fuel the fire of their ambition to change the world, tell them the truth." So how could I have possibly gotten to the place where I'm at now without someone telling me the truth, an elder telling me the truth, someone who knew, who was not beguiled by youth? I was blessed with the teachers who did not pay homage to youth in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest bit. Super important. Whereas the world is literally bowing to the altar of youth, the Whore of Babylon, bowing to that temple. To that pagan temple of paganity has always been about beautiful youth, worshiping youth, youthful vigor and vitality. That's the pagan religion. And that's where we're at now. So to find teachers who pay no homage to youth whatsoever is fantastic. And they tell you, "Hey, forget about trying to transform your world and everything. Pay attention on discovering the truth about this world and finding out you don't need to transform it except for one step of choosing to perceive timelessness, which is a non-measured state, a state that doesn't need any measurement. Perception that we have here is measurement of everything, constantly measuring everything. Our distance, our motion, what color everything is compared to other colors. Everything is comparison and a measurement. You get the gurus in this world, even when they have a young body, they not identify with their body at all. They seem ancient. They seem timeless. Neither young nor old, nor anything in between. They have absolutely no attachment to their youth, to their body. What age the body is, nothing like that. Again, that's quite startling to us. Because we don't realize how pagan we are as a culture. My God, as a culture, we are fanatically pagan. Fanatically. And again, let's not condemn ourselves for that. That's just where we're at right now. I mean, I'm sure I have touches of paganism. Absolutely. We all do here. Really. So that's okay. When you're living in the ocean, you're going to be wet. And we're living in an ocean of just rabid paganism. So when in Rome, do as Romans do. To a certain extent, at least, to not bother the gendarmes. But then again. Say, okay, but let's look deeper here. Let's find out the truth here of the situation. Don't give yourself over to it. Don't give yourself over to it entirely or forever. I mean, if you go through phases of testing out paganism, you go through phases of it, then you back off and say, "Wait a minute, let me reconsider this. Let me reconsider a minute. This doesn't seem like it's it." But my gosh, let's face it. I mean, even religions these days are quite pagan. Even those things which are supposed to free us from paganism are quite pagan. Becoming more so all the time, just to survive. Adapt or perish here. Yeah, so right now, what I do is affirmations, which are like a drill press. If you're like having, let's say you have to cut a lot of holes, drill a lot of holes through wood, and you have to do it by hand. Imagine that. Ah, really tough, right? If you get a drill press, it's just like, just, it's no stress on you at all. Affirmations are like a drill press. They just go right through the resistance to it. It's like a diamond hole saw blade. You can, cut through tile, porcelain, concrete. They make steel. Yeah, you can cut through steel with diamond. Diamond will cut through anything. So you, what they do is they put little diamond grit around the rim of whatever the cutting, what's going to do the cutting, and then it's the diamonds that cut. I don't know how they fuse them to the cutting instrument, but diamonds will cut. So affirmations are like that. It's like a diamond cutting blade, a diamond grinder, just grinding through the toughest stuff fast. And then it's also helpful right now to say, how would I feel if Jesus showed up, or similar to that? How would I feel? That's an interesting meditation right there. The first thing is throw out every notion that we ever had about Jesus. Throw it all out. It's all nonsense, really. Throw everything out. You have to greet him fresh. Greet him fresh. Greet him completely fresh. Why not? Truth is always true. So whatever you're throwing out, you're not throwing out truth. The truth will still be there for you. So literally, we can throw out everything, all concepts, all notions, everything, and truth will still be there. It's the one thing you can't throw out. Everything else is just reactions to truth, interpretations, etc. But truth itself cannot be thrown out. So when we throw everything out, what has to be left is truth. So Jesus being truth would still be there. Concepts don't matter. Because the expectations of Jesus are so off the mark, so off track. It's just amazing. Absolutely amazing. So if you want to greet someone as true, throw out all notions you have about them. Because if you have faith that they are truth, the truth is going to be purely there for you, no matter what you throw out. It's going to be there. But people have all these conceptions of what Jesus must be, and they cling to these conceptions, say, okay, no, this is what Jesus is. This is definitely going to be like this, and has to be like this because this is what I've been taught, this is what I believe, and this is what makes sense to me, etc., etc. And so they insist on that, and then they say, well, if Jesus doesn't fit those criteria, can't be it. It can't be Jesus. It's impossible. How's that so? That's basically saying that someone's saying, well, they already know exactly what the truth is. So anyone who doesn't meet what they know the truth to be can't be the truth. But by definition, they're admitting Jesus is the truth. So in fact, what they should do is throw out every conception they possibly have, knowing the truth will still be there. But they won't do that. So there's something wrong. It must be that they don't really believe it's Jesus in the first place, right? So otherwise there should be no problem with throwing everything out. So probably the first criteria would be the willingness to let go of everything, let go of all judgments. Truth doesn't need judgments. It's still true. Facts don't need judgments. Still facts. So in other words, we drop the judgmental aspect of our thinking, our believing. They say, let's let that all go. Because how does that help? How does that help truth at all? Does truth need some sort of help? Is it some judgment? We need to judge truth? The truth is that truth doesn't judge. So what we're basically saying is like, well, I think I know what Jesus judges and what Jesus doesn't judge. We don't know Jesus at all then. Don't know him at all. We know the devil. What we're saying is we must know the devil, really. The adversary. Delusion. The ego. Hypotheticals. That's not Jesus. To say, if we say, if we're saying that we have a pretty good idea what Jesus judges and what Jesus doesn't judge, then again, that's delusion. But if we say we have a pretty good take that Jesus doesn't judge at all, then that's preparation. Your mind won't be flipped out. You won't feel flipped out. You expect no judgment, and there's no judgment, so your mind's not flipped out. What was that? It's some creature in the night there. Just, I wonder if that was the cat. Probably. I don't know. What else is climbing around on trees at this time of night? Well, I don't even think Jesus could say that he's Jesus here, because it would cause like this intense conflict and consternation among people. Like, they're saying, no, you can't possibly be. What are you talking about? You don't fit our mold. You don't fit in the mold that we've made for you. Maybe that's why when Pilate said to Jesus, you know, who are you? And Jesus, you know, basically said, you say I am this or that. He didn't claim anything particularly, you know. He asked the apostles, "Who do you say I am?" And then Peter said, "You're the Christ," you know. But so, the rest of them didn't know, and he's just saying, "Do you know? Do you know? Do you know? You know, who among you know? I've told you, but who knows? Who knows? Who can see it? Who realizes? Who's willing to say that they know?" But that name, Jesus, is attached to so many judgments in this world. Wow, it's judgmental. Incredibly judgmental in so many different ways. Good, bad, and indifferent. We don't realize the high indifference. And people will say, what side of these issues are you on? Just let us know. Give us a hint. Can you just hint? Everyone would be so interested. Can you just hint? Please, we want to know, is this okay or that okay? What? How should we vote? How should we, you know, do this and that? And that would be interesting. That would be very interesting. Instructive, very instructive, actually. I mean, imagine going to Ramana Maharshi. Say, Ramana, I came here all this way to India, and I just came here to ask you, how should I vote? How should I vote? You know, what political party should I belong to? What's in the right here? What's in the right? And what about this issue here? You know, I'm sure people would ask Jesus, what about abortion, Jesus? Okay, that's, you know, number one thing. Probably abortion would be a very big one, right? And then if Jesus gave no answer, then they'd say, wow, You know, you're terrible. You mean you condone the murdering of all these unborn babies, you know, and it's like that. And then the others would think, by giving no answer, that they might be agreeing with the other side. They'd say, "Wow, you don't care about women's health at all. Wow, you're terrible." So basically, everybody would think he's terrible, terrible, because he's not giving any positions at all. He's just telling that God doesn't take positions on symbols, on dreams, on hypotheticals. To do so would ensure that we never set down hypotheticals. It would ensure it, literally. If God actually did take a position on anything at all, symbolic, other than perfect non-judgment, which is not really a position, but we can say it is for the purpose of speech, that would guarantee that we would never set hypotheticals down, or we'd be trapped forever in this horrible nightmare. Absolutely trapped. Now, let us say that a guru does give a position on something. Does that mean that God has a position? No, it does not. I mean, gurus here with bodies and talking and interacting and everything like that, they can occasionally say stuff that maybe they wish they hadn't said. Or they might say something to calm someone down or something like that. There's a human touch to it all, you see. But in no way, shape, or form does anything a guru say here in this world change the facts about God's perfect non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, all symbols. No way whatsoever. That's why Ananda Maima would say, said that she never said a single word here. She insisted she never said anything. She said, "Everything that I've said, are words that you've put in my mouth. Everything." Pretty amazing. In other words, don't think that I have some position on anything at all, or that God has a position on anything, or is judging these at all. That's not true. That's not true. Because everybody wants to know, hey, what does God think about the opposition, you know? Is God really against my enemies? They want to know. They want to know. They want to know if they're in the right, if they have a righteous position. People want to know, well, what kind of a righteous position can I take so I can feel empowered to defeat my enemies? And they got pretty angry at Jesus for not taking any position. Love your enemies, he said. Yeah, don't judge your enemies. Don't judge at all. Boy, they said they didn't like that, because we don't like that, because it's pacifying the countryside. We want everyone to take a position against Rome, you see. So, Jesus would cause a furor here. And basically what would happen is that, not being able to break his will, break him down, what they do is they try to break all those who want to listen to him, pay attention, try to break their will down, break them down. That's what would happen. So there's a question: is in Jesus' promised return, is he really going to come here and stay in this world? Or does he say, "Look, my will can't be broken down at all, but yours can. So if you want to follow me and listen to me and hang out with me, we're going to have to go somewhere else, because this place is bound and determined to crush your. Break you down and crush you and get you to believe that there's some judgment taking, out of necessity, some judgment has to take place. That God has to take sides, has to do that. Which again would guarantee, if that were true, it would guarantee our never incapacity to awaken from hypotheticals. We'd see hypotheticals as the only safe place there is for us. We would say, "Whoa, God creates the unreal too, creates hypotheticals too, huh?" Yeah. So maybe Jesus will just say, "Hey, you need to get out of this place." That's possible. See, that's a distinct possibility, actually. And those who want to follow Jesus will have to realize, put their pride down and say, hey, okay, we can't stay here because Jesus can handle the heat, but the heat's going to be turned up on Jesus' followers. That's where the heat's going to be, because then they'll realize, hey, we can't crush the head, but let's crush everything else we can. That kind of thing. And they most certainly can do that. No question about that. Like St. Peter said, no worries. And Jesus said, you're going to then renounce me three times for the rooster even crows. And that's exactly what happened. So, you see, if the rock Peter would just crumble like that so easily, you know, what about us? It's stupid to think that we wouldn't crumble. It's arrogant to believe that. So these are interesting speculations, because the time is nigh for sure when we have to decide which way to go. And if we decide to go with non-judgment, is a distinct possibility that relocation is in the cards. That's a possibility, because this world is bound and determined to crush the very notion of non-judgment as being a totally inhumane, totally insane, totally impossible. The world is insisting that God recognizes some symbols as having more relevance than other symbols. Which would mean that God doesn't create only the real or the eternal, or any, you know, which means reality is not real. Which means everything that about reality is not true. It just means that we also are not true in reality, which means we would try to then find a home in hypotheticals and symbols, and we'd feel attached to symbols, existence, which most of us in the world are super attached to this world, to symbols, believing that this is our home, or we have to make this our home, which just showcases the fear of God, the fear that God has judged the world, does judge the world, and thus is judging symbols, which means reality isn't real, as it were. The reality apparently is no more, because we know God didn't used to have any judgment upon symbols, because there weren't any. So if God is judging symbols as having relevance, then reality can't be real. It's impossible. And we know our home's destroyed, and therefore we figure out no choice but to make the best of this situation. So the idols that we have made are designed to help us make the best of this situation, make this world, that make this house a home. And that's Enter the goddess, goddess of home and hearth, as it were, who is the great idol that informs us how to, and motivates us, forms and motivates us to keep working on making this house a home. For those who believe that that reality is no longer real because God has judged hypotheticals, what ifs. The only reason why God would judge what ifs is if what if had some relevance. In other words, we say, what if at some point reality could be destroyed? And then for God to say, no. I mean, I don't like that, or I don't like this aspect of that, or I'm judging that. That means God is saying that, hey, this has the power to happen. This hypothetical could happen, you know, or it must not happen. It must not happen, which means God is admitting that it has the power to happen. So then there'd be some power, hypothetical power over reality forever and ever and ever. And we'd be working on trying to avoid that. And that we could not trust reality as our home any longer. We'd be completely insecure and scared and frightened, all of that. All of that. We don't quite see that yet. We don't haven't worked it worked through being able to recognize that. The consequences of God, of believing that God is judging hypotheticals, is totally consequential. To believe that, it then entraps us in hypotheticals. It entraps us. We have no choice but to be terrified and to be unwilling to go home, unwilling to wake up. Absolutely. That is the price we pay. Absolutely, that's the price we pay. That's a terrible price. Terrible, 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 terrible price. Nobody, we don't want to keep paying that price, do we? We don't want to keep paying that price, no. It's too severe. Very severe. We don't even realize how severe it is. We don't even realize the depth of our fear, any of that. So, the question I can ask myself is, would I go with Jesus, or could I handle Jesus being here? I don't know. I don't know. Yet to be determined. But certainly want to use my time in that direction to be with someone who's certain of the truth is invaluable, really, is invaluable. And you just have to notice the certainty. That's basically it. You just notice the certainty. It's not a question of agreeing or disagreeing. You just say, it's there. I see the certainty is there. So just observe factually that it's there. The certainty is there. Whether I disagree agree or not, it's still there. And that's the important thing. That there is certitude. There's no wavering. It's not some mental effort there. It's certitude. And certitude beyond anything that we've come across. And you just pay attention to that certitude and say, huh, wow, they really are certain. Effortlessly certain. And then you realize there's a higher degree of certitude than anything you've ever experienced before, everything you've ever seen. And then you A-B it compared to some of the great geniuses of the world or great leaders or whatever you want to A-B it to. And then you realize, wow, the certitude is way, 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 way greater. In fact, it's incomparable. Apples and oranges. Then you say, huh. You know, it would seem like this sort of certitude would come from truth. And so you just notice. Quietly, carefully, just noticing. And you see it, and you say, okay, that's quite something, that's amazing. And there's something really, this is built on a foundation of truth. So what is the truth? And then you find that out, and then you give it the benefit of the doubt, and you take a closer look and keep looking at it. Just like that. Nothing really mysterious about it. It's just that we studiously avoid it, and so it seems to be a mystery to us. It's like a certain place in your town that you never have gone to, and you've avoided it like the plague, and it's mystery to you. And finally one day you take a look at it and you say, what? Is that all there is there? Huh. I thought there was something really mysterious, and there's nothing there. It's just weird. It happens to me all the time where I'll be looking and I'll see a street or something that I've never seen in over 50 years of being in the same place. And I say, how in the world did I not see that before? Because I thought there was something I shouldn't look at or something mysterious. I want to avoid looking there. Now I say, oh, there's the driveway and there's the house. I see a house in there. Oh my gosh, it's nothing, no big deal there. Wow. But we studiously avoid those things that we want to shroud in secrecy and mystery and fear and all this stuff that we want to avoid. Want an excuse. Say, oh, no, I can't look at that. No, I can't recognize the truth. It's too unfamiliar to me. So we avoid it so we can make the excuse of unfamiliarity and continuity. They make a great excuse. Continuity is, we use it as an excuse. But if one has spent the time, which I have always made a severe effort to pay attention to all the saints and holy people throughout history, then it's not such a big deal. The only problem is having them in the flesh right now. Where do you find them, really? I don't know. I keep thinking I should just go around and go to all the teachers I can find. But on the other hand, that gets me quite kind of irritated because I feel like it's a waste of time. It doesn't feel like the best usage of time. Because then you get the, well, who am I? Who are you? Who do you think you are? Are you a body? Are you a mind? Who am I? Okay. But well, I see the teaching as God's perfect non-judgment upon all of, you know, all symbols is I see that as more relevant than, you know, who am I? Now, maybe for some people, who am I works great. Doesn't really feel that way as far as working for me. It might, I don't know. But it just never seems like it's that relevant. Now, what does it matter? I mean, if there's a continuity issue, there's a continuity issue. It doesn't matter the word games, what I am or say I am. Or, you know, that's beside the point. There's fear. There's fear. There's concern. It's spirit that's afraid. Something's being afraid. Something's entertaining fear. Something feeling fear. There's something that is nervous and frightened. It doesn't matter what you call it. I, not I, self, whatever. What's causing the fear? Why is there fear? Is the question. Why is there fear? Is the question. That's how I see it. Why? What's there to be afraid of? And they say, well, there's no I, so there's no one to be afraid. Okay, so there's fear, there's just no one being afraid. Okay. That seems like kind of like a parlor trick. There's definitely spirits afraid. Spirits are very afraid that it's destroyed its home. And there's no fooling around with this I thing. There's no I or something. There's still spirit, and spirit's the one that's afraid. So how does saying, well, there's no I, how does that cure the fear? It seems like there's a lot of, like, I'm smiling, I'm happy, I love you, and then in order to get that back, to reassure. The real gurus are not like that. You get the impression the real gurus are not even looking at you. Not even seeing you, not even the remote. There's this tremendous remoteness, and they're not even concerned with anything, anyone smiling at them or anything like that. It doesn't, none of that matters. It's a different feeling. So just to say, well, there's no I and nothing to be, no one there to be afraid, the fear's there. Well, why is there fear there then? See, it doesn't answer that question. It's trying to answer the question by getting rid of the questioner. And that's something that I just don't go for. There is a reason why we are there's fear, because we tried to become prime creator, displace the prime creator. And this brought about a situation in which we feel that reality is vulnerable. And since we are, reality is all one, if reality is vulnerable, we're vulnerable to annihilation. That's where the fear comes from. All right, we mean spirit. So spirit's got every right to question what's going on and get to the root of fear. And if you just say, well, there's no questioner, so let's not even question it all. We don't need a question because there's no questioner. There's no one there to be afraid. All this stuff, that's just kind of like trying to, you know, that's just a little trick that doesn't seem to be where it's at. Saying there's no one to be afraid. Well, the fact is, if God is judging anything at all, that would mean that reality could be annihilated, which would mean that we should be very afraid, as a matter of fact. So either God is judging or not judging. If God is judging at all, even the tiniest aspect of hypotheticals, even the tiniest, we have every right to be absolutely terrified. Every right, it would be impossible not to be terrified. We would be terrified, and we'd be working like crazy to construct a home in hypothetical land, in our imagination, an imagination that could survive the annihilation of reality. Absolutely. And if God is not judging any aspect of hypotheticals at all, we have no reason to be afraid at all. And we don't need to get rid of an I for that to be true. We can have an I or not an I, it doesn't matter. There's no reason, no cause, true cause of fear at all. The snake is seen to be a rope. You know, so and it's always been a rope. So, you know, who gets the relief? If there's no I, how can there be any relief? If there's no I, how can there be any bliss? I mean, if there's no spirit, how can there be any bliss, relief, salvation, repentance, any of that stuff? It just I don't know. It seems to me just That's the way I see it. And then, of course, they would say, well, who's the eye that's seeing it? And I'd say, Spirit is the eye that is seeing it. Who's the one that is asking? Who's the one that's saying there is no eye, you see? That's the question. What is the one that is relieved that there is no I? What is the one that cares that there is no I? Is or is no I in the first place? Who cares? What's the one that cares? Who wants to be free of the I? See? Who wants to know? Who wants to know what identity is? Who wants to be free of false identity? Whether that one thinks it's an I or not an I, or whatever it thinks itself to be, the facts still remain. Reality still remains what it is. Spirit entertaining hypotheticals still remains what it is. The continuity problem still remains as it is. All that stuff. Now, apparently, Ramana Maharshi had a way that the fullness of his teachings had a way, you know, to that. The fullness of it. But he said it's very profound. You have to go beyond a certain point that most do not go beyond in order for it to really, the fruit to be there. So any approach can work if you take it all the way to the true recognition of God's perfect non-judgment. Any way can work. So the I way can work. Any way can work. but also that anyway could not work if it's not taken there. That's also true. So in the non-dual teachers, I don't see this remoteness. I don't. They're still thinking that they're human beings. Maybe human beings without an eye or something without an eye or whatever, but there's still, there's not that true high indifference. It's not there. For the most part, I don't know, there might be some I have that's possible. But by and large, it's like you go into a market and there's like a million cuts of chicken everywhere, and you're looking, and then in the one little section there's this organic, free range, no antibiotics, or totally organic and no pesticides and everything. Ah, okay, one little area is, it's like it's got the real stuff that's palatable if you happen to be a carnivore. Same thing could be said about, vegetables or something or truly organic. So yeah, it's in a big marketplace, you might be able to find something that's really organic. But this is of utmost importance. Is usually we get what we want. They say the disciples, they get the teacher they deserve, and that seems to be true. So people want a certain type of, teacher, and that's what they end up getting. Yeah, it's amazing. In the Bible Belt of Australia, Queensland, or some really hardcore Bible Belt there, there's someone who says he's Jesus there, and is teaching them what they want to hear. Is teaching them what they, giving them the red meat. Say, yeah, I'm Jesus, and this is what they tell them what they want to hear, and it just, it's that way all over the world that the teachers tend to reflect their disciples, those who come to them. And I think teachers are, if they're not really truly enlightened, are like prisoners of their devotees. And they're somewhat baffled by it all. Confused and baffled. And I've noticed that. That there's some sort of like feeling like this is all kind of like kind of weird. A little bit weird. What's going on? Not quite sure. Who's doing the teaching? Who's the teacher here? And I'm not really sure. It's like maybe I'm being ganged up on and bullied. The feeling the teacher's like, well, all these devotees here, they're trying to convince me that God does judge symbols. They're ganging up on me, but they're letting me play the role of teacher as an excuse to get access to me, to gang up on me. Okay, that's something that you teachers out there should consider. Okay. You should consider the possibility that you're being actually ganged up on, being tricked. Let's say you're targeted because you're very advanced and getting close to recognizing non-judgment, and then you get all these people coming to you and saying, "Oh yeah, you're such a great teacher, such a great guru. We all worship you, and you've got the truth, truth and all this stuff." Well, then that gives them access to you, right? If you accept that role, then they have all this access to you. And then they can start subtly undermining your progress that you have made. All the while you think that you're teaching them, they're actually trying to teach you. That's worth considering, because that's what I've noticed. And there's degrees of this, but I can't say for sure that there any teacher that I know in the world that is, you know, perfectly free of this dynamic and has that true, complete, pure indifference, high indifference of God's non-judgment. I can't come up with anyone. And for the most part, I see there's definitely an attempt on the part of the devotees to be the real teachers, and they're saying, hey, this one, we don't want, let's reel this one in, you know. And the lure is that they will accept you as a guru or a teacher. That's the lure that they put on the hook. You see, they say, oh, there's a fish that's trying to get away. Let's throw this line in the water and put this beautiful lure on the hook, and then the person swallows grabs the lure and gets hooked. And so now they're hooked on the role of teacher. And then that's when they get schooled by the devotees. And the devotees, of course, are playing this game like they're so interested in, tell us the truth. Oh, yeah. Oh, tell us about there's no I, and okay, this, oh, I'm trying to get it. I almost get it. It's so beautiful. I feel that yes, and there's a yes, yes. Oh. They go through the song and dance, you know, they're really good at this song and dance. And yet they don't quite get it. The teacher's like, thinking like, wow, what's going on here? There's kind of a little, it's just a little bit weird. I thought they'd get it, and I thought I was helping them, but isn't it? Not quite. Not, that doesn't seem to slips away. But so the teacher's like, kind of like thinking, wow, and starts sinking in. Maybe, you know, they think about, oh God, maybe God is judging something. I get this feeling of what must be something, maybe something, you know, just a little something, and see, and that sidetracks them, gets them off track. They don't finish. The best teachers are those who maybe have gone through this and then they realize, hey, I need to take a half a step back. I need to drop this role of guru here, and let me see what that's like. And some have done that. Some have stopped. Some have stopped being gurus, actually. There's quite a few. There's quite a few who came out as gurus and teachers and light and who stopped being teachers and disbanded. That's happened. I've noticed that. That's promising. That's promising. That's some wisdom going on there. Because maybe they found out that they're just being tricked. Someone was doing a very clever job on them, trying to reel them in. That's why for me, don't want to be a guru at this point, no way. Just a mid-level teacher who's not enlightened, plain and simple. That's the truth. But maybe farther along than some gurus in the world, because I've avoided that, of being set up like that. So I've been able to keep going. I'm not threatened by devotees leaving, you know. There's no threat, really much threat in that. Because the devotees have power of the guru. You know, they say, hey, if you don't kind of make some little concessions to us, we're going to leave, and we're going to say you're a false guru, you're nothing, you know, collapse your total identity. And the guru then starts to make some accommodations, you know, which is what they wanted, which reinforces their own whimsicality and own expectations and beliefs that yeah, we need to make this house a home in Hypothetical Land. It reinforces it, you see. So sometimes the greatest good that the Holy Spirit can do for you is to make sure you don't be a guru, you know, protect you so you're not a teacher. I always ask the Holy Spirit, I said, Holy Spirit, I know more than they do. How come I'm not a teacher? And then the Holy Spirit says, no, you don't want to be a teacher. Forget it. It's kind of like, I look at the teachers, I say, wow, you know, they're not, they could certainly be doing better than that. But again, it's often a setup. And again, the real teachers, Ananda Maimok, absolutely care less if anyone saw her as a teacher or not. Totally care less. She was willing to leave all disciples behind. And she did. She did. I mean, she was in Bangladesh, Dhaka, as they call it, and Shahbagh area, and had many, 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 many disciples there. Great devotees. Very august people, you know, and society people, and intelligent people, lawyers, high court judges, surgeons, civil servants, and people from all walks of life that were just intense devotees. They said she's the greatest thing there's ever been. Now we have, you know, we know what Chaitanya was like. Now we know what is like. Now we know what God is like. Now we know, and they're just so devoted. And then one day she said, I'm going to take a trip, and I'm kind of basically going to be leaving you now. What? Freaked them out entirely. Completely freaked them out. And she did. She got a, took her husband and I think one traveling companion and got on a train and went up to Dehradun. That's it. Now she returned occasionally, etc. But from that point on, she's just wandering around. She's not looking for any, you know, to be seen as a guru or a teacher or have devotees or anything like that. Was indifferent to it. So it couldn't be trapped. You see, couldn't be trapped in that. Was not willing to be trapped in that role at all. Made no difference one way or the other. But that's very rare. That's very rare. It seems like teachers here usually finally end up saying what the devotees want them to say and agreeing with them, you know. They become like their devotees. If their devotees are on a big ego trip, then the guru ends up being on a big ego trip. If their devotees are really want to do a bunch of stuff, the guru ends up going along with that. You know, it just, and of course they can conveniently blame the guru later, you know, it's the guru's fault. If anything goes amiss, it's the guru's fault. They're the ones. So it's better for most gurus to go out of the guru business, which is tough for them because they're used to having their every whim, you know, satisfied. I mean, how do you let go of that and go dig ditches, you know? So if it's either agree to the demands of the devotees or go dig ditches, what do you think the guru's gonna do? that's it, you know. But the ones that really want salvation, they gotta do it. They gotta say no, you know, enough's enough. I'm not quite up for this. They can just say, look, I'm not the perfect teacher, And it's best that we, let's not pretend that I am. And it's best that you seek within for the answers. The Holy Spirit's within, the perfect teacher's within. And right now I need to do myself, I need to do some more clarification work. And so that's what I'm going to do. And no more robes, no more throne, no more, you know, entourage, no more this, no more that, and say, let's this, you know, I'm going to disband this, and we're all going to, you know, continue looking within. It's been done. It's been done. It can be done. And of course, the devil takes one like that. They say, "No, no, 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 no. Well, do anything you want. Just don't do that." You know, because they really want to be reassured that their position is right of judgment. You see, that they're right in trying to make believe that this world is real and try to make it real, seem real, seem realistic and comfortable, so we don't want to go home. After all, if your home was completely destroyed, why would you want to go home? And any inclination that you have to go home, you would be terrified by it. You say, "Oh my gosh, I got to stamp out this inclination to go home. That's terrible, because I would just end up being completely devastated by what I see. There'd be nothing there. Annihilation of my home. I don't want to go home, so I want to avoid going home." That's what they, you know, that's what they feel. And like Muji said, he says, "Don't be a satsang teacher. I don't recommend it to anybody." It's nobody wants to be a satsang teacher. Let me tell you, he says, it is really tough. I mean, it is really something. He says, someone asked him, "Do you have any that you've said to go teach? You know, have you told anyone to go teach?" He says, "No, no, 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 no. I wouldn't do that. No, no, no. I won't tell anyone to be a satsang teacher." He says, so, because it's no picnic, is it? Because of course, the devotees are—they're trying to be reassured that they're right. And they're trying to get the guru to agree with them. And they're willing to do any song and dance there is to get the guru to agree with them. Any song and dance at all. You name it, anything. Anything at all. But willing to be brutalized. Anything. Tortured, brutalized, you name it. They're willing to do that to get this guru to agree with them, because the non-agreement of the guru with their position seems to be very threatening. That's the facts. Because the guru says, "No, you can go home. Everything's fine." And they say, "Oh, no, it isn't." They say, "No, no, I'm sure God has judged something, and that means that reality is not real. It means reality can be destroyed. It means it's vulnerable to destruction. We've already carried out so much destruction here, hypothetically. That means we've most likely completely wiped out reality, and you want me to go home? Are you crazy? You know, this is terrifying. You're terrifying me," and all this kind of stuff. So what happens? The devotee is willing to agree to the small bliss or something. Ramana called it some kind of, you know, happy euphoria or something. They're willing to go that far, you see. They're willing to go that far. And it's amazing what we can do, what fear can do. Fear can get us to mimic, you know, can get us to do that. And so we're capable of pretending to be truly blissful. We're capable of that, and we do that, and then call that good, you see. say, okay, we're doing that, and now they say, this is what you want from us. This is what you are too. This is your endpoint too, because this is ours. We've done what you asked of us. But that's not it. That's not the true endpoint. So I don't know. Hindsight will show who really has made it. But it's never a bad idea for a guru to disband their whole situation. It's never a bad idea for that. For a guru to say, okay, everyone, you know, this is enough for me at this point, and I'm going to do something else, and I'm forget about my name, forget about this ashram, forget about this everything. We're going to, you know, wind it down and call it a day for now. And for the guru just to spend some time like that, maybe incognito or something, that's usually a good thing to do. Go somewhere where nobody knows you, where we don't have any name, you don't have any fame, nothing. Just abide there, and just keep it fresh. You know, don't let the devotees get too much of a foothold. Keep the devotees. Keep it fresh for them too. Keep them on edge. Don't let them think that pretense it will work. Let them throw them back on the inner guru, as it were. Throw them back on the inner guru. Make them really sweat it. And they might, you know, say, wow, I better re-examine, you know, the whole situation here. Interesting satsang here, that's for sure. Creates panic in the devotees, panic. But if they're really true devotees, why would they panic? They just continue their internal satsang. Just continue on. Say, okay, do whatever you want to do. Do what you want to do. It's not going to stop me. It's not going to bother me. I know that the teacher is within. The Holy Spirit is within. It's always with me. So if I whatever help I need, I'm sure I'm going to get it. So it's no worries. No worries. In psychology therapy, they call it transference. The therapist has to be very careful of transference. This is some kind of spiritual transference, but it's a little more great, more depth to it than psychology understands. Psychology is really child's play. It's really the work of dilettantes. And they, you know, of course, dilettantes have their own groups and associations and clubs celebrating their, how profound their dilettantism is, but, you know, it just, it's very superficial, really. Very much so. But some of the stuff is, you know, in the ballpark. It's like little league compared to major leagues. You know, it's the same baseball field, and you know there's some similarities to it. You know, but yeah, that's a rough one. I'm telling you, trying to be a genuine teacher in this world, that's rough. That's I don't know. That's why so many fail at it. Good grief. Yeah. I can't even imagine myself doing that. It's beyond the scope of my, you know, seeing like what's possible. Is that really possible? Are you kidding? The way the things are now in the world, good Lord. The pressures that can be brought to bear now on teachers is unbelievable. It's like a open season on spiritual teachers now, open season. Absolutely. Maybe that's why Jesus doesn't seem to be reinforcing too much of that, saying, hey, you know, look, let's take a vacation from this situation so that we can come back at some time and be really helpful here. But you need to really have a lot more seasoning. A lot more seasoning. You cannot be caught up in the transference situation. You cannot be caught up in that the devotees trying to turn the tables. Because when the students feel that the curriculum is too difficult, they're going to try to flip the tables. Even in school, in our schooling, you realize that where some those who felt the curriculum was too difficult, they would start plotting to disrupt the classroom and get the teacher in trouble and all that stuff. I know, 'cause I've been there and done that. You know, like chemistry, we wanted to get rid of the chemistry teacher. You know, students definitely have their schemes about the teacher. So of course the real teaching is so uncompromising that devotees are going to want to say, wow, we need to change this teaching. This teacher is very charismatic, but we need to change the curriculum so we can get an A in the class. I mean, we can't get an A in this class the way it's being taught, no way. So we got to change it. And if the class seems too difficult to people, they won't even take it at all. They'll say, I'm not going to sign up for that class. There's no way can I get past that class. So what happens is some teachers pretend that the curriculum is a lot simpler than it really is, easier than it is. So a lot of people come to them, and then they feel like, wow, I can't quite get this. And the teacher will say, well, it's not that difficult. And so there's this dance, this game going on between the student and the teacher. The teacher saying, no, it's simple. Easy. And the student says, no, it's too hard, it's too hard. There's this, you know, playing with this whole dynamic is what happens a lot. And that's a, you know, it's a dangerous game for the teacher. They got to really, 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 really be established in truth to play that game, that is for sure. And even then, it's probably a good idea to take some time off from it and just, you know, take the car in for a checkup, as it were. Yeah, definitely. Just to renounce all attachments, even to teaching for a while, and say, I'm just gonna let things cool off for a while and see how I feel about it and see if I want to keep doing it and see where I'm at. And why not? Doesn't a teacher have a right to do that? Why should we put anyone on a pedestal so high that a teacher has no right to do that? When Jesus was asked, well, how come you don't come back here? His response was, presumably his response was, well, hey, he said, look, I give you your freedom, perfect freedom. Let me have mine too. He's saying, hey, I'm enjoying my freedom, and I'm free to do what I feel, what is called upon to do, what I want to do. I'm free, and he's not desperate to come back, or he's not feeling like he needs to come back to justify anything or anything like that. Kept the door open to coming back, but saying, look, I'm also enjoying my freedom. I'm enjoying my freedom, as you will too. So the idea is, if we get free, then we have to come back here. Why do we want to get free if getting free just means we have to stay here? And that's so he's basically saying, look, I'm when you get free, you probably want to enjoy your freedom too. You will, and you will want to, not maybe, definitely will want to. So this is all stuff that's very, very interesting to consider. And having considered it, we become a lot wiser. We just kind of say, very, very interesting. And just continue this honesty, inner honesty, 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 honesty. Ask the Holy Spirit for help, 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 help. Where is this fear coming from? Why am I so scared? Why is the world so weird? All this stuff, there's got to be an answer. There is an answer, absolutely. I'm positive of that. The Holy Spirit's answer is given to me. I'm very comfortable with it. Saying, yeah, this fits. The glove fits. If it doesn't fit, you must acquit. But if it does fit, you must not acquit. Right? So, if the glove fits, say, hey, this is it. This is true. And if you do like some kind of teaching like this, which is just a sharing of encouragement, then you don't feel like it's so important to be some kind of guru or something like that, really. I mean, if that happens, it happens, or whatever the Holy Spirit wants. But it's like you kind of, if you try to share with others something like this, then you just say, well, I've sort of been there and done that to some extent, and it's like not some kind of really, really important thing we want to do. If you're truly competent, then that's something, but kind of low key it, but it's an interesting thing to do. Absolutely. Probably make more progress that way than just about any other way. I feel like I have definitely made more progress this way than just just made tremendous progress. Just the willingness to share this with the world, anyone at all can view this. There's no restrictions. That's some kind of willingness. It's not like there's some retreat and there's some special people and we're just telling them, whispering to them this truth, and then that's it. This is just creative commons. Anybody can watch it. I have no control over who watches it, and anyone can comment. I have no control over who comments and no control over any of this stuff. So that's interesting thing to do. And I don't know, it may not always be the best idea, maybe sometimes it is probably maybe best to do it in different ways too. But it might be the best way to give this information out into the world. because otherwise the transfers might be too severe. If you try to do it in a guru setting, this kind of information, oh man, I think that people would just be like flip out. As far as if you're in a guru disciple situation, as it were, I think the transfers will go off the chart. Off the chart. Maybe that's why Jesus gave the A Course in Miracles out the way that he did, by having it transcribed by Alan Shuckman and Bob Tedford. And because if he came here, gave this stuff out, the transference situation would be crazy. And people would be like desperate to get him to say something different. And so he said, no, I'm not going to even be here at all. So can't do that at all, which is a great blessing. When he left, they said, why are you leaving? He says, well, it's better for you if I leave. It's really better for you if I leave, but I'll send you the comfort of the Holy Spirit, which will help you out. So, you know, that's what he said. It's better for you if I leave. And it's probably, I'm sure that's true at that point. So, this is a good opportunity here. There's, you know, very little opportunity for any transference or anything like that. So it's able to look at stuff that you wouldn't ordinarily be able to look at without just like feeling like you've got to change the mind, you know, change someone's mind like that. And you can just say, well, I don't know, it's beneficial. It seems like it is. So we get to say stuff that ordinarily would not get said, that's for sure. Just like telling gurus they should all take a break from their guru-ness. Take a sabbatical and check in. It's worth it, why not? The ones who are truly, 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 truly 100% confirmed in acceptance of God's perfect non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, perfect eternal non-judgment, they don't need to take a sabbatical. They might do it just for the benefit of their devotees too. Whereas the other ones who are not totally convinced do definitely could benefit from a sabbatical too. That's possible, you know? So, sometimes scandal forces it upon them, forces the whole situation to dissolve. Yeah, which is probably a good thing for both. You know, scandal is not always a bad thing, because it can end up with everybody saying, whoa, let's take a step back here and let's check out what's going on here. And, yeah. All right, very great. Moving on. Not watching the news. Feel a lot more relaxed. You see, the path is difficult, and people want to avoid the difficulty. But by avoiding the difficulty, one can't help but draw false conclusions, which can't help but keep the fear of God in place. So one has to be a workaholic, really, on the spiritual path. That's the safest way, to be a workaholic. So it doesn't matter whether the guru's there or not. You know you're going to be working at it full blast, one way or the other. The fact that I've never had a guru here in this world, that hasn't kept me from working full blast. I says, hey, if you don't want to show up, that's your problem. I'm not going to stop working, and I'm still going to get it. Now, it might be nice, but you know, I'm not going to sit around waiting. Got to go full blast, no matter what. Most people think that the guru comes just to tell them how right they are. And they're just waiting for the guru to tell them, just affirm how right they are. And it's not true. We've got it all. We're all mixed up, confused, and afraid. And it's hard work to untangle this tangled web. We have a very tangled web. We've woven a very tangled web full of massive defenses against the fear, against examining the situation. We think the situation, we already know what it is, and it's terrible, and we don't dare examine it. We don't dare examine it because we feel reality has definitely been completely messed up. It's totally vulnerable, and if we even examine it at all, that may cause its entire destruction. You know, so we just have to stay away from a whole huge area, just absolutely avoid it at all costs. And we hope the guru is going to help us avoid it at all costs. In other words, we see the gurus, oh, here's the one that's going to help us avoid this area at all costs. And that's what we want. So if we're lazy at all, that's a devastating thing. That's the one thing, if I look back on my life, I can say, was I lazy? No, I couldn't be called lazy. Now, I doubt anybody can say they gave it everything they got. You know, it always seems to be maybe a little bit of procrastination holding back, but laziness? No. No way. So, you check in with yourself and ask yourself that question. Looking back on your life, let's say today was your last day, you look back and say, you know, was I lazy? Was I lazy? Did I lead a life that could be considered in spiritually, in any way spiritually, lazy, a lazy life, spiritually speaking? There's no way I could characterize my life like that. No way. So then you know that you've been leading a righteous life, a truly righteous life. And that righteousness will pay off in bliss. Payoff will be there if you just keep going, keep working at it. There's no substitute for it. The guru is not a substitute for work. The guru is an encourager of the work. A guru is like a physical trainer, a workout trainer that says, do more reps, come on, do more reps. You can do more than that. What are you trying to get out of more reps? What are you, you're not really that tired. Come on. He said, you lifted that much yesterday. Today you're stronger. A little bit more. Come on. Two more. Oh, you did it. That was easy. Those two more. One more. Okay. Oh, wait. One more. Give me one more. Okay. Now, take a little rest and then, okay. And then, to the next thing and... Come on, push it. You're better than that. You got more in you than that. You're not giving it everything you got. You're giving it 90%. I want to see 99%. Come on, 92, 93, 94. Come on, you're just coasting. Push it, push yourself. You got to do more. Like that. That's the guru. That's the guru. The guru's just saying, come on, work at it harder. Don't be so lazy. Don't let laziness get hold of you. Don't let complacency grab you. Don't get complacent. As soon as you get complacent, that's got a hold on you. So that's the guru. The guru is not flattering you. I don't know. I, Your guru should not be flattering, you know, by saying, yeah, you almost got it. Yeah, you're right there. You're right there. That's it. You got it. I don't know. That's kind of flattering people, really. It is just flattering. They're not there. They don't almost got it. Everybody almost got it. But the getting of it requires this panoramic clarity. And so you got to tell them, say, look, you know, you've got to keep after this. Like a hound dog on a trail. You don't see the hound dogs giving up when they're following a trail. You know, we got to have some hound dog in us. That's the truth. We as a culture in the world, we've gotten so lazy, it's just unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable. It's all fast food. We want fast spirituality now. That just doesn't work. We got to have stick-to-itiveness. That hound dog's got to want, says there's something at the end of this trail that is just, that I got to have it. Be salivating, you know, just salivating for it. Every day I'm salivating for that. I'm going to follow that trail. And no way am I going to stop today. I'm going to get it today. I'm going to find that. And then when you don't find it, you keep on trucking. And you go after it again tomorrow, even faster. No substitute for that. So I don't know. I'm just wary of the teachers who play that game of, okay, I'm gonna lead you right into enlightenment. Here we go, and they say, you almost got there. I mean, you touched it, you got it. Did you get it? Yeah, you had it. There's a little more. Okay, you got it there. Okay. Okay, it's all right. Great satsang here. In some cases, maybe, but it could be a lot of flattery there, too. The guru's flattering themselves. Guru's flattering themselves in, you know, that situation. You cannot just lead someone into a vision of timelessness that is truly it, like that. You've got to build up the panoramicness of it, the context of it, the depth of it. The whole thing has got to be there. And then when it's there, it's there. One about the guru says, "Look, you don't get it, and you're not going to get it right now. You're not going to get it today. You're not going to get it tomorrow. You come to this retreat, you're not going to get it here. You're coming to see me, you're not going to get it. You're not going to get it. No way. Not even close. Not even close. Because you don't realize." How close you really are. See, you don't realize that. You don't realize that there's nothing you need to do at all. It's the totality, the no exception whatsoeverness that people are so far away from. They're so far away from that. But that's where you have to get to. To say, well, you simply need to make no exception. Yeah, well, just try doing that. It's easier said than done. So it's easy to say it. It's easy to talk about it. It's easy to play with it. But to do it, no. It's not easy. So where is the guru says, look, everybody, there's a big satsang. They're on a tour. And everyone comes to them, you know, big ticket prices, you know. Wow. Lots of books to be sold, CDs, and everything else. And the guru gets up there and says, look, everybody, you know, who are you kidding? Who are we kidding? You got a long ways to go. I mean, you're not close. You've got a lot of clarification. There's so much stuff that's all twisted up. And, you know, there's no way in the world you're going to get it tonight here. So So let's start being honest, and let's start being practical. Let's start realizing that we really have to work a lot harder at it. And it doesn't matter, you know, whatever contact high you get, that's not it. So forget about the contact high. Forget about getting it here tonight. Forget about it. It's not going to happen. You're not going to get it. And you're not going to get it anywhere. Right now, it doesn't matter where you go, who you see, you're not going to get it. You're going to get it by dedicated work every single day and not and by refusing to give in to your laziness. That's how you're going to get it. Of course, everybody would say they want their money back. And the sellers of all their books and CDs and their whole publishing company would freak out. I say, are you kidding? We've capitalized this business to this huge extent. We got all this debt. We can't give the money back to people. No one's going to buy our book. What are you doing? Are you crazy? What kind of guru are you? You're terrible, you know. You know, all I ever get from Jesus is that, you know, you're not there. I mean, you got a ways to go. He really, you know, no. I say, am I not close? And it's like, nah, not really. Nah, not really. Not really. That's the feeling I get. Like, nah. You got potential, but, you know, it's nothing. I don't know. So I just say, wow. You know, just have to keep working like crazy at it and just not give up and keep working day after day. But if the guru says, oh, you're so credible, close, oh my gosh, you're right there, you know, okay, then you have a tendency to give up your super strong efforts every day because you think, oh, I just need to, I'm there, I'm so, you know, okay, I can now ease into it. I'm there. I'm finished or whatever. Close. And even if you're close, it's best not to think that way. Power through the finish line. Don't start thinking about crossing the finish line. That there's nothing worse if you're trying to finish a race than thinking about crossing the finish line. That's the worst thing possible. Like when I was running, I had to. Boy, you start thinking about, hey, where's the finish line? Goodbye energy. It saps you of energy. Slow down. It's like, isn't it near here? Is it here? You know, don't think about it. Just saying, I'm gonna deal with this section right here really great. And this one, and then this one, and this one. And then finally you see the finish line not up ahead, and you say, well, you know, I don't know if that's the finish line or not. And, you know, if it is, it is. If it isn't, but anyway, I'm just going to, like, totally go for it as much as possible. And if I cross the finish line, great, but I'm going to be going full steam ahead. Don't get complacent. Start thinking about the finish line. Ah, it's pretty close. Start getting complacent. You know, it's like swimming against the current. As soon as you stop swimming against the current, there may be like a stone that you can, or a big rock that you can get to, and you see the rock and you're swimming upstream, and you almost grab the rock and you say, oh, I'm so close. But the current is powerful going in the opposite direction. So if you stop your powerful swimming, and you start, oh, okay, let me feel for the rock. Is it up here? Is it, I'm almost close. You'll get swept back downstream away from the rock. So what you have to do is you have to power into to that rock, just power into it, and just, wow, full speed, grab a hold of the rock and pull yourself out of the current. Don't slow down at all. If you slow down at all, you're going to be swept away. I don't know if some teachers like tell people, hey, you're so close. It breeds complacency in some ways. It can, or people get inspired by the teacher and they work even more diligently. That's possible too. A lot of stuff is possible. But basically, what people do when they go see the teacher, they basically say, "Well, how can I get it now? How can I get it now?" And they might get a taste of that, you know. But the teachers just say, "Don't worry about getting it now. Don't worry about getting it. You really don't have to get anything. There's nothing to get, really, other than to realize there's nothing to get." It's because we're thinking, what is the exception? Just let me know what God is judging. They think the guru knows what God is judging, that the God finally whispered to the guru, "Hey guru, okay, you now understand me, and I got a little secret to tell you. I really am judging something. I'm judging this, you know, but that's only the initiated should know that." Some might be thinking, "I'm not judging at all, but I'm letting you in on a little secret." You know, that's what they think. The guru, God has whispered in the guru's ear and told them what they're judging. So everyone goes to the guru saying, "Okay, what is it about me they're judging? Where's the judge? I'm going to find out what it is. If I just play the game, I can find out." So they're assuming. Even the guru says, "No, they're not." They say, "Ah, the guru's just holding out on me." They're just holding out. They're not telling me because I'm not ready yet. But when I'm ready, they're gonna let me in on God's secret. Now, God doesn't have a secret. The secret of God is that God does not have a secret. And who's ready to accept that? You see, who is ready to accept that? God doesn't have any secret. The mystery of God is that there is no mystery. Who's ready to accept that? You see. Everybody thinks the guru is just testing them, testing their loyalty to the guru. Say, "Oh no, guru, we know that you know a secret, that God does have a secret. It's just that you're looking to see who is ready to have the secret shared with them, you know." And you say, No, God doesn't have any secret at all. There's no mystery whatsoever. Nobody believes it. Nobody believes it. They think the guru is playing some kind of game, some kind of test of their loyalty, you know. Not true, not true, not true. There is no secret. God has no secret. God has no secrets. God has no mysteries, no secrets. None. None. No judgments. No judgments. None. Go away and say, "I didn't get what I wanted. I didn't get what I wanted." But then the mature practitioner will go home and say, "Okay, let me sit down, okay? Be as quiet, non-reactive, non-judgmental. Let me just sit in this non-judgmental, non-reactive condition. Let me be centered, peaceful. Continue on with my spiritual practice and clarification." And then at some point, something may dawn upon them, like, "Ah, wow, I got a great lesson there. I saw the mind's work. I saw the mind wanted something. It didn't get it, you know." So they become aware of the game that they were playing. The mind was playing. They became aware of the game that mind was playing. And then they get a little bit more wary about that game, you see. So those things happen. Absolutely, they do. Yeah. There's the whole A to Z, A to Z, A to Z in any situation, really. There's so many different things that happen. All right. What's happening right now is that I'm going to click stop recording on this. Oh, I see. It's up there. Okay. Ah, 2 hours and 24. Is that possible? Ah, I thought it was 1:24. It's 2:24. Wow. It's late. It's late. It's late. It's late. There's an airplane flying overhead at midnight. Why? Why do they have low-flying planes at midnight? flooding planes at midnight. I can't relate to it. I cannot relate to it. People flying like a pitch darkness up there in the sky. I don't know. Just, that's really something. It's amazing the things that I think that are just like, I can't even conceive doing it. And then what I'm doing, maybe people can't even conceive of this at all. They can't conceive of it. To me, I say, of course I know how to do this. But to me, like piloting a plane, that's like no way as far as what I'm talking about, the terrestrial planes flying at night and all this. No way. No way. Maybe piloting a different type of plane, interdimensional planes, a whole different thing. But what the pilots do here, good grief. Man, that's really a different mindset. I guess you could get used to it. If you have the right training and the right techniques and all that kind of stuff is there, then the whole thing comes together for you and you're able to do it. But that's a tall order. But of course, if you make that your purpose, then you can do it. But our purpose here is to recognize that salvation is God's acceptance, that God does not judge, has never judged, never will judge symbols, hypotheticals at all, which is our guarantee that our home is perfectly, always flawless the way it's always been, our guarantee. No worries, God's saying. No concern, no worries. Have no worries, no concern whatsoever. I'm totally indifferent to all symbols, not even paying the slightest attention to them. I know what I created is real and always will be real, is not threatened by symbols at all. So you, since I created you, you have no worries either, you see? That's our purpose, to see and accept that. All right, that's a wrap.